edsvideo.com. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. Dr. Carlo Oger, emergency physician for the ED Exit Video YouTube website. In this video, I want to talk about hemoptysis, which is coughing up blood. And I actually have a very nice patient education video already done within my channel. You can search under uploads under the word hemoptysis, and you should look at the patient side of the education of hemoptysis. But this is really for the emergency workup. What does an emergency physician or nurse, paramedic, medical student that is first confronted with a patient who's complaining with hemoptysis, what steps to do, what is the differential diagnosis, what is the initial treatment, and how to treat this patient? So today I had a patient who was in the ER a few days back with bronchitis symptoms, cough, congestion, was put on antibiotics and inhalers, but today started coughing up with bright red blood. And I'm gonna show you a video that shows that kind of sputum. You can see the sputum, it's clear, slightly yellowish, with some bright red blood clots. Well, the first thing we need to define on any patient who complains of hemoptysis, they're not gonna say that word, they're gonna say, I'm coughing up blood. You have to differentiate true hemoptysis from pseudohemoptysis and from hematemesis. True hemoptysis means truly you're bleeding in your bronchioles and then coughing blood up. Pseudohemoptysis means they're coughing up the blood, but it's not coming from the bronchioles. It's coming from their nose, or they have a broken gingiva and then the blood's coming out through that. Maybe they had a really bad sore throat with bleeding through their tonsils, and then that's coming up and coughing up blood. Different sources. So that's pseudohemoptysis. And then there is hematemesis, which is vomiting blood. So that sometimes it's hard to tell for patients. They're coughing up blood or vomiting up the blood, but it's very important to try to differentiate those. What we're talking about here is about those patients that actually have coughing up of blood. And the second thing you want to find is how bad is the bleeding? Divided in non-massive hemoptysis, which is less than 200 mL, or less than one cup of bright red blood in their coughing and their sputum, or massive hemoptysis, which is more than 200 mL. Actually, more than 1 liter in 24 hours is considered severe hemoptysis and carries an 80% mortality rate. So what different things can cause hemoptysis? Well, in children, it's usually an upper respiratory infection. Just got a sinus, an upper respiratory with cough, and then just bring up some blood. Or they pick up the nose as the blood came back, and then they coughed it back up. And foreign bodies, maybe they put a pee in their nose or a coin or aspirated something. So foreign bodies and lower respiratory infection are the two most common reasons for hemoptysis in kids. In adults, it's usually bronchitis or pneumonia, so lower respiratory tract infections, but also bronchogenic carcinomas. You gotta think about cancer in these patients. What are the other causes? Were TB? Does this patient have weight loss? Have they been exposed to TB? Did they come from another country? Also mycetoma, which is kind of saying fungal infection. And when you think about fungal infection, you think about immune compromise, or they've been outside the country, aspergillosis and other diseases like that. Are they on anticoagulation? They take aspirin, Coumadin, Plavix. You know, do they have problems with their INR or something like that? Also, pulmonary hypertension can end up having some blood in the cough or hemoptysis. So one of the first tests you're going to do is an X-ray. Do they have pneumonia or not? Do they have mass? And you'll start with an X-ray. If the X-ray doesn't show the answer, well, it kind of depends. If the story suggests bronchitis or upper respiratory, well, you can just treat him and wait to see what happens. But most of the time, especially in adults, they'll end up getting a CT scan and or a fiber optic bronchoscopy. Take a look inside and see where the bleeding's happening. The treatment is targeted at three things. One, to make it stop. Number two, to prevent aspiration. And three, to find what's causing the bleeding so we can stop it. Now let me warn you, in 34% of the cases, no cause will be found. It'll be termed idiopathic. And these carry a very benign prognosis and not associated with any bad disease, even though it's scary to be coughing up blood. But in 23% of the cases of hemoptysis, cancer will be the answer and it'll be the diagnosis. So you can see why to the patient, so important we admit him, work him up, and make sure they don't have cancer or something like that. What about pulmonary embolism? One of the big things with pulmonary embolism is, are you coughing up blood? Well, hemoptysis is a rare cause. PE is a rare cause of hemoptysis, but if you have it, then it's pretty specific, and they're much more likely that you have it. So just because they're coughing up blood doesn't mean they have a pulmonary embolism, But if you have a pulmonary embolism, there's a good chance you might have some coughing up with blood. Now, if the hemoptysis is associated with menses, this is a really cool thing to know. It's called catamenial hemoptysis. And there's such thing because sometimes females can have endometriosis in their lung. Endometriosis is abnormal glandular tissue from their uterus, and it can be present on their lungs. And when they have their period, they actually bleed into their lung, and they can cough up blood. So that's something cool to know, and if you know this, you'll be smarter than most doctors too. Catamenial hemoptysis. So what is the workup? Obviously, you're going to do a CBC, a complete blood count. If the white count's up, that'll be more infection. If the platelets are low, maybe the patient has idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura, ITP, maybe thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura, TTP, or some other platelet disorder. What about the hemoglobin? If hemoglobin is already low and they're coughing up blood, you're going to be more aggressive, you're going to be more careful, you're going to give blood transfusions and so on. But a normal white count, normal platelets, normal hemoglobin, certainly very reassuring that this is a benign disease and they might be able to go home. What about PT, PTT, INR? Obviously, somebody who's never had any problems bleeding, the likelihood of PT, PTT, INR to be abnormal is very low. You only order PTTs to diagnose, inherent clotting disorders. And if they haven't had that diagnosis by now, it's probably pretty rare that you're going to make that diagnosis today. But certainly, if they're on Coumadin, you want to check their INR level. If they've been on Lovenox-Shot or some kind of blood anticoagulant, that would be a major cause. You're going to do an ABG, an arterial blood gas, and that's looking for hypoxia, signs of hyperventilation, CO2 retention that might indicate COPD or other causes of bronchitic problems and bronchiectasis or some other diseases of the lung. A D-dimer. D-dimer is looking for clotting disorders and more specifically pulmonary embolism. A high D-dimer will be high risk for PE, but there are many other things that can give you a high D-dimer like a thoracic dissection, which can also present with blood in the sputum. A sputum sample with maybe cultures and analysis. If they actually can produce a good sputum and it shows malignant cells, then you have pretty much your diagnosis right there. If the sputum is green and yellowish, maybe they had an infection, maybe it's tuberculosis, aspergillosis, or some kind of other infectious disease. A PPD, which is the skin test for tuberculosis, you might want to do that. And of course, it needs to be read in 48 hours. That won't be a result you'll have right away, but something to consider. HIV testing, if this patient by any chance is immune compromised, they have a weird x-ray, maybe some immune compromise with the atypical pneumonia, definitely you want to do HIV. And ESR or SED rate or CRP are non-specific tests at inflammation in general. So you want to do those tests to see if there's something infectious or not or whatever. So let's go back to the case. This patient presented with minor hemoptysis after a recent diagnosis of bronchitis. The x-ray just shows a very small pleural effusion and no pneumonia, no cancer, or anything like that. We order a CT of the chest, which at the time I'm making this video is pending, and the patient is getting ready to be admitted to the hospital because the pulmonary doctor wants to do a bronchoscopy to find out what it shows. So I can't really tell you what it finally did show yet, but I might be able to tell you in the comments and follow-up. I hope you learn a lot about hemoptysis and most importantly, the emergency medicine treatment and assessment. Bye-bye.
EDSVideo.com. Thank you.